द ब्लू बीड बाय नोरा बुर्के। फ्रॉम डीप वाटर केम द क्रोकोडाइल, आउट ऑफ ब्लैक वाटर कर्व्ड विद वर्लपूल्स एंड इनटू द फ्रिल ऑफ गोल्ड शैलोज बाय द स्टेपिंग स्टोन्स। He was twice the length of a tall man, and inside him, among the stones which he had swallowed to aid digestion, rolled a silver bracelet. Timber was being floated down this great Indian river from the forests further up, and there were sleepers lying stuck around the stones until someone came to dislodge them and send them on their way. Or until floods lifted them and jostled them along. The crocodile had no need to hide himself. He came to rest in the glassy shallows among logs and balanced there on tiptoe on the rippled sand with only his raised eyes out of the water and raised nostrils breathing the clean sunny air. Around him, broad sparkling water traveled between cliffs and grass and forested hills. A jungle track came out of scrub each side and down to the sun-whitened stepping stones on which a little flycatcher was flirting and trilling along. The mugger crocodile, blackish-brown above and yellowy-white under, lay motionless, able to wait forever till food came. This antediluvian saurian, this prehistoric juggernaut, ferocious and formidable, a vast force in the water, propelled by the unimaginable and irresistible power of the huge tail, lay lapped by ripples, a throb in his throat, his mouth running almost the whole length of his head, was closed and fixed in that evil bony smile. And where the yellow underside came up to it, it was tinged with green. From the day, perhaps 100 years ago, when the sun had hatched him in the sandbank and he had broken his shell and got his head out and looked around, ready to snap at anything before he was even fully hatched. From that day, when he had at once made for the water, ready to fend for himself immediately, he had lived by his brainless craft and ferocity. Escaping the birds of prey and the great carnivorous fishes that eat baby crocodiles, he had prospered, catching all the food he needed and storing it till putrid in holes in the bank. Tepid water to live in and plenty of rotted food grew him to this his great length. Now nothing could pierce the inch-thick armored hide, not even rifle bullets, which would bounce off. Only the eyes and soft underarms offered a place. He lived well in the river, sunning himself sometimes with other crocodiles, muggers, as well as the long-snouted fish-eating gharials, on warm rocks and sandbanks where the sun dried the clay on them quite white and where they could plop off into the water in a moment if alarmed. The big crocodile mostly fed on fish, but also on deer and the monkeys that came to drink, perhaps a duck or two. But sometimes here at the ford, he fed on a pie dog full of parasites or a skeleton cow. And sometimes he went down to the burning huts and found the half-burned bodies of Indians cast into the stream. Beside him in the shoals, as he lay waiting, glimmered a blue gem. It was not a gem though. It was sand-worn glass that had been rolling about in the river for a long time. By chance, it was perforated right through the neck of the bottle, perhaps. A blue bead. In the shrill, noisy village above the ford, out of a mud house, the same color as the ground, came a little girl, a thin, starveling child dressed in an earth-colored rag. She had torn the rag in two to make skirt and sari. Sibya was eating the last of her meal, chapati wrapped round a smear of green chili and rancid butter. And as she divided this also to make it seem more and bit it, showing straight white teeth. With her ebony hair and great eyes and her skin of oiled brown cream, she was a happy, immature child woman, about 12 years old. Barefoot, of course, and often goosey cold on a winter morning, and born to toil. In all her life, she had never owned anything but a rag. She had never owned even one anna, not a paise, not a pie, even to buy, say, a handful of blown glass beads from that stall in the bazaar where they were piled like stars, or one of the thin glass bangles that the man kept on a stick, and you could choose which color you did have. She knew what finery was, though. She had been with her parents and brothers all through the jungle to the little town at the railhead where there was this bazaar. And she had walked through all the milling people and the dogs and the monkeys full of fleas, the idling, gossiping, bargaining humanity spitting beetle juice, heard the bell of the sacred bull clonking as he lumped along through the dust and hubbub. She had paused, amazed, before the sweetmeat stall to gaze at the brilliant honey confections, abuzz with dust and flies. They smelled wonderful, above the smells of drains and humanity and cheap cigarettes. At home, she sometimes tasted wild honey or crunched the syrup out of a stalk of sugarcane. But these sweets were green and magenta. Then there was the cloth stall, stacked with great rolls of new cotton cloth, stamped at the edge with the maker's sign of a tiger's head, and smelling so wonderful of its dressing, straight from the mills, that Sibya could have stood by it all day. But there were other wonders to see. Satin sewn with real silver thread, tin trays from Birmingham, and a sari which had got chips of looking glass embroidered into the border. She joined the crowd round a Kashmiri travelling agent on his way to the bungalows. He was showing dawn-coloured silks that poured like cream, and he did got a little locked chest with turquoises and opals in it. Best of all, a box which, when you pressed it, a bell tinkled and a yellow woolen chicken jumped out. There was no end to the wonders of the world. But Sibya, in all her life, from birth to death, was marked for work. Since she could toddle, she had husked corn and gathered sticks, and put dung to dry, and cooked, and weeded, and carried, and fetched water, and cut grass for fodder. She was going with her mother and some other women now to get paper grass from the cliffs above the river. When you had enough of it, and you could take it down by bullock cart to the railhead and sell it to the agent, who would arrange for its dispatch to the paper mills. The women often toiled all day at this work, and the agent sat on silk cushions smoking a hookah. Such thoughts did not trouble Sibya, however, as she skipped along with her sickle and homemade hay fork beside her mother. You could skip all the way out, but not on a way back when you ached with tiredness and there was a great load to carry. Some of the women were wearing necklaces made out of lal beads, the shiny scarlet seeds, black one end that grew everywhere in the jungle. It was the best to have necklaces each year instead of last year's faded ones, and Sibia was making one too. How nice it was going to be to hear that rattling swish around her neck as she frouched along with lots of necklaces. But each seed, hard as stone, had to be drilled with a red hot needle, and the family needle was snapped. So she must wait till they could buy another. Oh, for strings and strings of glass and beads, anklets, earrings, nose rings, bangles, all the gorgeous dazzle of the bazaar, all her little golden body decorated. Chattering as they went, the women followed the dusty track towards the river. On their way, they passed a Gujjar encampment of grass huts where these nomadic graziers would live for a time, until their animals had perhaps finished all the easy grazing within reach, or they were not able to sell enough of their white butter and white milk in the district, or there was no one to buy the young male buffaloes for tiger bait, or perhaps a cattle-killing tiger was making a nuisance of himself. Then they did move on. Sibia glanced at the Gujjar women as she went past. They wore trousers, tight and wrinkled at the ankles, and in their ears, large silver rings made out of melted rupees, and one of them was clinking with a stick against the big brass gurras in which they fetched water from the river for the camp to see which ones were empty. The men and boys were out of camp just now with the herd or gone to the bazaar to sell produce, but one or two buffaloes were standing about, creatures of great wet noses and moving jaws and gaunt black bones. The Gujjars were junglies, as Sibia too, born and bred in the forest. For countless centuries, their forebears had lived like this, getting their living from animals, from grass and trees. And they scratched their food together and stored their substance in large herds and silver jewelry. They were man in the wandering pastoral age, not stone age hunters and not yet cultivators. Ah, now there was the river, twinkling between the trees, sunlit beyond dark trunks. They could hear it rushing along. The women came out on the shore and made for the stepping stones. They had plenty to laugh and bicker about as they approached the river in a noisy crowd. They girded up their skirts so as to jump from stone to stone, and they clanked their sickles and forks together over their shoulders to have ease of movement. They shouted their quarrels above the gush of the river. Noise frightens crocodiles. The big mugger did not move, and all the women crossed in safety to the other bank. Here, they had to climb a steep hillside to get at the grass, but all fell to with a will and sliced away at it wherever there was foothold to be had. Down below them ran the broad river, pouring powerfully out from its deep narrow pools among the cold cliffs and shadows, spreading into warm shallows lit by kingfishers. Great turtles lived there, and mahseer weighing more than 100 pounds. Crocodiles too. Sometimes you could see them lying out on those slabs of clay over there, but there were none to be seen at this moment. Where Sibya was working, wind coming across hundreds of miles of trees cooled her sweating body, and she could look down over the river as if she were a bird. Although she did not dare to stop for a moment under her mother's eye, her imagination took her in swooping flight over the bright water and golden air to the banks where she had played as a child. In those cavelets above the high water mark of the highest flood, she had stored some little bowls molded of clay while they hardened. If there were anything that could be used for coloring, they would look fine, painted with marigolds and elephants. Child! The sharp word, the glare of her mother's angry, sweating face pulled Sibya back to work, and they toiled on. But at last, it was time to go back and see to their animals and the evening meal. The loaded women set out to cross the river again. Sibya hung back. She would just dawdle a bit and run and see if the little clay cups were still there in the cave, waiting to be painted and used. Although the women were now tired and loaded, they still talked. Those in front yelled to those behind. They crossed the river safely and disappeared up in the track into the trees on the other side. Even their voices died away. Silence fell. Sibya came down alone to the stepping stones. The light of the evening was striking up the gorge, pink into the ultraviolet shadows. Now that the sun was off it, the water poured almost invisible among the stones with no reflection to show where it began. Sibya stepped onto the first stone. She was heavily weighted, her muscles stretched and aching. The hayfork squeaked in the packed dry grass and dug into her collarbone, so close under the skin, in spite of the sari bunched up to make a pad. When she was halfway over, she put up her load down on the big boulder to rest and leaned, breathing, on the fork. At the same moment, a Gujjar woman came down with two gurras to the water on the other side. In order to get the good clear water, which would quickly fill both gurras to the top without sand, she walked onto the stepping stones. She was within a yard of a crocodile when he lunged at her. Up out of the darkling water heaved the great reptile, water slushing off him, his livid jaws yawning and all his teeth flashing as he slashed at her leg. The woman screamed, dropped both brass pots with a clatter on the boulder. When winds, they bounced to the water and Sibya saw them bob away in the current. Oh, the two good vessels gone. The Gujjar woman recoiled from the crocodile, but his jaws closed on her leg. At the same moment, she slipped and fell on the bone-breaking stone and clutched one of the timber logs to save herself. The logs jammed between two boulders, with the woman clinging to it and screaming, while the crocodile pulled on her leg, threshing his mighty tail, bang, bang, to and fro in great smacking flails as he tried to drag her free and carry her off down into the deeps of the pool. Blood spread everywhere. Sibya sprang. From boulder to boulder, she came leaping like a rock goat. Sometimes it had seemed difficult to cross these stones, especially the big gap in the middle where the river passed through like a bulge of glass. But now she came on wings, choosing her footing in mid-air, even without thinking about it. And in one moment, she was beside the shrieking woman. In the boiling water, the face of the crocodile, fastened round her leg, was tugging to and fro and smiling. His eyes rolled onto Sibya. One slap of the tail could kill her. He struck. Up shot the water 20 feet and fell like a silver chain. Again, the rock jumped under the blow. But in the daily heroism of the jungle, as common as a thorn tree, Sibya did not hesitate. She aimed at the reptile's eyes. With all the force of her little body, she drove the hay fork at the eyes, and one prong went in, right in, while its spear scratched past on the bony cheek. The crocodile reared up in convulsion till half his lizard body was out of the river, the tail and nose nearly meeting over his stony back. Then he crashed back, exploding the water, and in an uproar of bloody foam, he disappeared. He would die, not yet, but presently, though his death would not be known for days, not till his stomach, blown with gas, floated him. Then perhaps he would be found upside down among the logs at the timber boom with pus in his eye. Sibya caught her arms round the fainting woman and somehow dragged her from the water. She stopped her wounds with sand and bound them with a rag, and helped her home to the Gujjar encampment, where the men made a litter to carry her to someone for treatment. Then Sibya went back for her grass and sickle and fork. The fork was lying in the river, not carried away, luckily. And as she bent to pick it up out of the water, she saw the blue bead. Not blue now, with the sun nearly gone, but no color white-blue, and its shape wobbling in the movement of the stream. She reached her arm down into a yard of cold silk water to get it, missing it first of all because of refraction. But there it lay in her wet palm, perfect, even pierced, ready for use, with the sunset shuffled about inside it like gold dust. All her heart went up in flames of joy. After a bit, she twisted it into the top of her skirt against her tummy, so she would know if it burst through the poor cloth and fell. Then she picked up her fork and sickle and the heavy grass and set off home. Aye, aye, what a day! Her bare feet smudged out the wriggled mark of the snake in the dust, where there was the thin singing of the malaria mosquitoes among the trees now. And this track was much used at night by a morose old Makna elephant, the tuskless one. But Sibya was not thinking of any of them. The stars came out, she noticed. On the way back, she met her mother, out of breath, come to look for her and scolding. "I did not see till I was home that you were not there. I thought something must have happened to you." And Sibya burst with her story, cried, "Something did! I found a blue bead for my necklace. Look!" Children, this chapter, The Blue Bead, is a huge chapter. I have noticed many children being lost in the way. Yes, I mean it. Children do not feel like going ahead in reading. There are too many descriptions, too many characters, and it is utter confusing for children to understand as to what actually happened, Yes, there was a fight between Sibya and the crocodile, but what do we have to do with this? So, here I have tried to make it easy for you, so that you understand and upgrade your English vocabulary. This lovely jungle story, full of figures of speech and a fantastic vocabulary used by the author, talks about three characters. The first one is the heroine, that is our lovely Sibya. The second one is the villain, and that is the crocodile. The third one is the supporting cast, and that is the Gujjar woman. The author has first very beautifully described the crocodile. So, as a student of English literature, you are required to learn the description of the crocodile. What he ate, where he lived, and how he grew up, escaping all the carnivores, everything. Then we have our main protagonist, the heroine, that is Sibya. So, for Sibya, you have to learn everything about her. What she wore, she was poor, how she helped her mother, and of course, her fantasies for necklaces. Also, she could not have any necklace because the needle was snapped. Snapped meaning blunt. Remember, she's a child, a woman child. So, she has longing for sweets. She has longing for good clothes. She has longing for bangles, for necklaces, for nose rings, for everything that the other women are using. So if you can closely notice, the first part of the chapter talks about the antagonist, the crocodile. The second part talks about our protagonist, that is Sibya. The third part talks about her fascination for jewelry, sweets, clothes. And then comes the supporting cast, the Gujjar encampment and the women living there. Of course, the jungle women going to the other side of the river to cut grass for the paper mills should not be forgotten. Then comes the little bowls made of clay, which Sibya had stored in the little cavelets, which she wanted to see. And for that, she dawdled and stayed behind, not joining the other women when they returned to their houses. And it is just because of this dawdling comes Sibya's encounter with the crocodile. Remember, again, Sibya is just a child, so she cannot have a direct encounter with the crocodile. So here comes the Gujjar woman as a supporting cast who had come at that time to fill water in her gurras. The crocodile pounced on the Gujjar woman and Sibya, our lovely Sibya, came hopping on the stones like a jungle goat and saved the Gujjar woman. The author has already told us in the first part when describing the crocodile that the crocodile's hide was an inch thick. Even the bullets could not pierce it. They would bounce off. So now comes his soft eyes and the yellow part, which was tinged with green because of the river algae, accessible to Sibya. Now, where does the blue gem come from? On the first page only, when the author is describing the crocodile, the author had clearly mentioned that he was twice the length of a tall man, and inside him, among the stones which he had swallowed it to aid digestion, rolled a silver bracelet. So maybe this blue sand-worn glass had come out of the bracelet? It can be clearly seen, as mentioned by the author, in the last paragraph of the second page. It was not a gem though. It was sand-worn glass that had been rolling about in the river for a long time. Remember about the snapped needle? And so, when the author mentions about this blue bead, the author clearly states here that by chance it was perforated right through the neck of a bottle, perhaps a blue bead. And so it ends on a happy note. It seems her fascination for gems, for beads, for necklaces, for her jewelry ended as a reward for her fierce fight with the mugger. So children, listen to the story again with all these points in your mind, and trust me, you will definitely do better. Thank you, and see you in some other audio. All the best for your boards. Bye-bye.